So you get the big fight with Heather Hardy coming up in a few weeks, but I do want to go back to October when you fought Lisa Blaine at Bellator 185. I was there. I was cage side. You know, in the judges' ruling, the scorecards didn't go your way. It wasn't stylistically, for sure, the fight you were probably hoping for. I had scored it for you. I know Renzo Gracie had your back, and a few other members of the MMA media world thought you won that fight as well. But did you feel like you had done enough to win that fight, even though you didn't really get that kind of fight you thought you would get?
Well, For me, of course, you know, I thought I won the fight. I felt like I was controlling a lot of the action. I felt my opponent was the one moving back, and it was very hard to engage. And, you know, once you step into that cage, man, when they lock up that door, you know, it's just you and your opponent. And, you know, I just really didn't get that type of a flow in there. And so it's something that I definitely, you know, learn from. I got to talk with like Frank Mir and a couple of other people about, you know, the whole experience. And it's, you know, it's interesting time, I think, in terms of MMA, and just because it's still a fairly young sport, and there's certain things that are highlighted over in the cage as you're working and as you're performing over other things, you know, that can be deemed as just as effective and just as important. And, you know, I feel like the game is going to constantly evolve and change, you know what I mean? And I just happened to not get the judges nod on that night. And it was just a matter of just one scorecard, you know. And you know, I didn't get hurt from the fight, you know, I was fine. I stayed a little bit longer in the East Coast, and the following week I ended up going to Carnegie Hall to receive an award, and no one even thought I fought, you know. And it's just one of those technicalities that, you know, just fall into the whole, you know, judging system, the scoring system. So you know, I just got to take it for what it is and just learn from it.
You know, specifically, you talk about, you know, John Kavanaugh says win or learn. There's no real losses in his world.
Yeah.
You know, so specifically, did you take anything away from that fight? I mean, I doubt Heather is gonna fight that way. I doubt she's going to stay away and avoid trading with you. And this is no knock on Lisa, because she was actually smart in how she approached that fight, albeit non-fan-friendly. But, you know, if you run into that sort of style again, did you take anything away that will help you negate that in the future?
Oh, 100%. You know, next day, you know, me and Angela were already talking about, you know, a lot of different stuff. And, you know, it's obviously, you know, we were very emotional about it. And, you know, we both thought we got the nod, but obviously we didn't. But there's, you know, there's always room for improvement. And, you know, you just got to adapt. You just got to be a martial artist. You got to be a fighter, and you got to learn how to, you know, just keep moving.
You talked about going to Carnegie Hall and receiving an award. For those who don't know, talk about that. What award did you get?
it was for the TOFA, the Outstanding Filipino Awards. So I was the sports person of the year for the Filipino community. And, you know, for me, you know, that goes a long way. It's very prestigious, and you know, I'm all about, you know, just supporting my heritage and stuff like that. And so it was pretty nice. My first time going to Carnegie Hall. It was pretty cool to get all dressed up and, you know, experience the whole shebang of it. And it's something that, you know, I'll always take with me for the rest of my life. But yeah, no, it was great. It's crazy. It was cool.
Did it kind of take the sting of the loss away a little bit to be in Carnegie Hall and get that award like that?
Yeah, I mean, I can't say that. Of course, you know, for sure. And, you know, and it definitely helps when you're with some really, really cool people. Like, well, one of the folks that I got to hang out with in the East Coast was Shannon Ambrosio. And if you guys ever get a chance, check him out on the cooking channel for his barbecue show. And he's a phenomenal cook. And him and his wife, Lourdes, they've been so gracious. And, you know, they were just so positive and just so welcoming. And, you know, I think a lot of that, you know, really helps for anyone who's gone through an experience like I have, you know, where if you feel down, if you have people around you who's just going to lift you back up, you know, then you're just lucky and fortunate to be around, you know, some great people, and you can eventually just keep moving forward, you know. And yeah, getting the award is obviously the icing on the cake.
You know, heading into Bellator 185, we had talked a couple of times, and I know you did a bunch of interviews talking about Heather quite a bit. Her not so much until fight week. She started responding to all the questions about you, and, you know, you took a loss. She had a really rough night herself with Christina Williams. Did you walk out of that event thinking that this fight with Heather was still a possibility, or did you think that this was off the table altogether?
You know, it was an interesting night. There was a lot to think about, you know, just But I felt like it all served its purpose. I felt like if I had not said anything leading up to that fight, we wouldn't be having the fight that we're about to have right now on February 16th. So, you know, it's funny how things work out, right?
Right.
But, you know, at the moment, I guess I can't really say that I was really thinking about it too much. There's obviously a whole bunch of other stuff that was on my mind. But since hindsight is 2020, I felt like it was the right thing to do. It's like, that was the perfect thing to do. I think had I not said it, I wouldn't be getting this fight right now, you know, especially with the way, everything turned out. But that's the fight game for you.
Absolutely. And full disclosure, I mean, I wrote this article on FanSided about 10 fights we need to see in 2018. That was on the list. And, you know, a couple days after that,
yes.
I've known this fight was happening for a little while now, but I'm a man of my word. I kept it to myself, but the news is out. It's happening, and it made all the sense in the world to me. And I remember, and we talked about this a little bit off air, I remember Angelo Reyes called me on the phone a couple of weeks after that fight at Bellator 185. And, you know, we talked about the fight. He talked about, you know, asked me what I saw, what I thought about it, and I gave my opinion on everything. And then we discussed what would be next for you, and he talked about all these different options. And then I went on this Jerry Seinfeld-sounding rant. My voice is going up and down. I'm like, this is still the perfect time to make you and Heather happen. I mean, with the two of you, this thing will deliver. It's a no-brainer. And now the added element of a boxing match on top of it makes it even more interesting. When did you know this was being discussed? Like, when did you get approached with this idea?
Oh my gosh. Well, first off, thanks for, you know, mentioning us in that article, man. It was a phenomenal article, and you guys need to check it out. You need to read it. So, and it's nice to have it actually happening. But in terms of having all of this fight transpiring, I mean, I think it happened. I remember talking about it with my boxing promoter, Alan Tremblay, back when I was doing my initial signing with Bellator. It was definitely a direction we wanted to head into, and it was something that had been in the plans. I mean, I was supposed to fight Heather Hardy on October 20th, but obviously it didn't materialize. So it's been a work in progress, and it's finally happening. And, you know, it's interesting how you actually knew about it, you know, and kept quiet this whole time. But I really thought everything was just in the keeps. But we've been training, you know, since my last fight, you know, whether the fight between me and Heather was going to materialize, you know, I just don't know, because that's just how the game works. You just don't know until it happens. And so because of that, I just stayed in the gym, and then I just had to, you know, reflect, and I got to move on and, you know, improve myself and adapt. And, you know, everything just ended up just working out the way that it did. So I would definitely say that this fight, it took a while to get together.
Now, I mean, we talked about this when we had our little conversation in my car, and I had asked you, you know, you had been training vigorously, working on different aspects of the game, but you didn't have a lot of time to really prepare for Lisa herself. Like, you didn't really have a lot of time to prepare for her style and everything like that. It was just kind of, all right, well, you know, we've already been working. Let's just keep putting in the work. You know, I know a little bit about her, and then let's go into fight. Now that you have a little more time, do you feel a little bit better about it? I mean, you've seen Heather fight a couple of times inside the cage. You know, do you feel a little bit better having a little more time preparing for a specific opponent this time around?
Oh yeah, 100%. And it's nice to actually get some activity. You know, I was able to get that fight, get that out of the way, and now I'm getting back in the gym, and I'm just getting preparing for this fight. And I feel like that whole just having that schedule and that mindset, and just living that in that type of environment, I think it helps any fighter. And so I feel like I'll be definitely a lot more sharper and more key to the game. And you know, it is something that I've been gunning for, you know, for a while. And I feel like it's something that the sport needed, especially women's MMA. And, you know, I'm just so happy it's freaking happening, and it's happening in the way that it is. You know, it's nice to actually know that I have this fight happening. And then right after that, I can start preparing for the next fight, talk about activity, getting that again, and just getting back into the ring. You know, it's such a win-win scenario, and it's so epic. It's hasn't been done before. I mean, you gotta imagine, man. I'm so pumped up. So while I'm in the trenches in the gym, you know, getting over whatever I need to go through, personal issues, you know, business issues, or even getting over the cold because of the season, you know, I'm coughing the blood, you know, nose is bleeding and stuff like that. I'm on my period, and here I am sparring with some guy who's just wanting to kick my ass, you know, but at the same time is trying to be there for me. So it's like a love-hate relationship, you know, and, you know, just dealing with all of that. And you know, but as soon as I, you know, get to sit just sit there and take a deep breath and just think of the moment. I'm like, you know, I have a fucking fight. You know, I can actually fucking do my job. I can be who I want to be. You know, it's like, this is what I live for. And I think that's the battle a lot of fighters have to go through, is just being in an organization or surrounding themselves with a team who's going to help them get direction in this game, because it's uncharted territory. You know, it's like going down to a casino in Las Vegas and putting in a dollar, a $5 bill, or $20 bill, a $100 bill on a slot machine. You know, you just don't know what you're going to get, but you just got to play, you know? I'm just so pumped.
I can't tell at all how pumped you are. It's unbelievable. I think this whole thing is very fascinating, and I think Bellator and everybody involved is doing this right. And the idea that I had, and you saw in the article, was doing the MMA fight, doing a boxing fight, and then, you know, best case scenario, I'm sure not in your case, is that maybe it's 1-1, and then you run it back a third time, and we'll see what happens. But obviously, the MMA fight is booked for February 16th, but has there been any discussion about the boxing match? Like, and obviously, it clearly depends on what happens on February 16th, but has there been a time frame discussed, a location? Is this going to possibly be in collaboration with Bellator? What can you tell us about the boxing match at this point?
Yeah, Mike, that's a great question. I mean, if there is, it's happening behind the scenes. One thing that I do know is Lou DiBella, Heather's boxing promoter, will be there at the fight. And my boxing promoter, Alan Tremblay, will also be there too. So, you know, for me, you know, as a fighter and being able to put on my fan goggles on too, you know, I'm thinking, he's like, man, you know, I won't even know, and I'm participating, I'm the one performing, I'm competing, and I don't even freaking know, you know, but I won't know until the end of the fight, you know. So it's so crazy, and it's so easy to jump ahead, but at the same time, because of the training and, you know, just getting into the trenches of everything, you know, it's like, I have to just stay in the moment. You know, I wish I could say, yeah, we have certain things set, but I really think it all depends on how banged up, you know, each one of us is going to get, because it's going to be a war, Mike. You know, I'm so tired of people saying, oh, Ana should have boxed more in an MMA fight, or she should have did this more. And I'm like, you know what? You know how hard it is to be a boxer and to achieve all the stuff that I did, and then get into a sport where they're exposing and giving a lot more support and opportunities for female fighters in MMA. And I'm like, well, I don't even get to go through the amateur program. You know, I go from pro to pro, and there's no such thing as a setup fight in MMA. And it's like, you know, I have to learn what I got, you know, and it's like, gosh, I have like this chip on my shoulder where, you know, I'm over at the Mayweather gym and I'm just going back to that jab. I'm like, man, you know, my body for the first time in a long time is saying, yeah, that feels right. Do that again. Crack, 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 crack. You know what I mean? And it's nice to get into that zone and getting pumped up about it. But again, I didn't mean to get off track. So to try to answer your question, I really can't. it really all depends on February 16th, and people need to tune in. And they need to watch, and they need to see what goes down between two boxers who are wearing 4-ounce gloves, and that's going to go for a 5-minute round. And 5-minute rounds are long if you're trying to go at a boxing pace. So for me, you know, I'm thrilled about that whole just challenge. You know, it's like fuck yeah. It's like everything's going to be all. Because we see it all the time, man. Fighters get tired because it's a long round and it's intense, you know. And it's like, I want to go through the fire. I want to go through it. And yeah, man, it's. I don't know. I'm really, really, really just thankful and happy, and I'm glad I did all the stuff that I did and said all the stuff I did back in the day, because I wouldn't be having this fight with this girl right now, because I know she wouldn't be calling me out. That's for sure. There wouldn't be any direction at all. You know, this fight is happening because I had to say a few things to actually, you know, get under her skin and actually have her, you know, bark back. So, man, guys, you probably tell, Mike, there's a lot of stuff that goes on in the fight game just to get things going, right?
You got my foot,
crazy business.
You got my foot tapping on the chair right now. My heart's racing a little bit. I'm getting really excited here. Are you really having fans saying stuff to you about that you should have stuck in boxing? Is that really happening to you?
Oh, 100%. Oh, 100%. And you know, for me, I'm thinking, man, it's loud and clear, man. It's not the same sport. Like when Mayweather went to go fight that MMA fighter, it's like, in a boxing ring. And I'm like, are you guys like serious right now? Yeah, I'm like, do you guys not understand that there is these sports are completely different. The pace is different. The wind is different. The endurance is different. The strategy is different. Even the way that you punch is different. And so, you know, and this is my whole thing with MMA is that I respect the fighting art so much because for every limitation that every art has, you know, there is a brilliance to each one and you have to find what brilliance that is that works for you. You know, and it's the same stuff that Bruce Lee had been saying throughout all these decades, you know, all of his quotes, all of his lines, all of his things about the way of fighting, you know, and it's like, man, you know, just give me a shot. Give me a chance. And that's what Scott Coker did and Bellator did. And they're letting me just at least get the activity. Let me figure my shit out so I can go ahead and do the shit that I want to do, you know, because it's fun. Like when you have, well, when you know what you have and, you know, everything is just hitting in all cylinders. And when I say hitting on all cylinders, I'm not saying, you know, a perfect camp where, you know, everything, you wake up in the morning and it's all sunny and birds are singing and stuff like that. It's like, you go through shit, you know, you hear crap from your family, you hear crap from friends and strangers, and you go to the gym, you hear more shit, and you hear your coach, you hear more shit, but then, you know, you find this brilliance, and even at your weakest point when you're just struggling because you're pushing your body so much, you still have, you're pushing that heart button, you know, thinking, I just want to get into the trenches. I just want to get through this. You know, I'm going to fight her. Fuck yeah. You know, I fell down, but I want to get back up. I mean, that right there, it's hard to find. You know what I mean? It's hard to find. And this is what I love so much about the fight sports is I would hate to be in a situation or in a job or in anything where everything that I do, it becomes robotic. You know what I mean? I'm just going through the motions. At least here in fighting, I can at least just experience life. You know, it's like life and death all at the same time, and you have the power to control it. You know, despite things going your way and things going the other way, it's something that you can actually control. But yeah, see, you get me so hyped up, Mike. I forgot the original point we got into, but you just got me so hyped up about freaking just training and fighting, man. I'm just trying to recover and hydrate before I get into my next session, dude.
I mean, obviously, when you have your family and you have that support system in there, and like you said, they're giving you shit and you use that as fuel. Does the stuff the fans say, does that add to that fuel, or do you just kind of ignore that altogether?
I think when I was younger, it definitely would, you know, it would get me just pumped up and get all upset about it. But now I'm like, you know, I can look anyone in the face and be like, man, like, well, what do you know? Have you ever fought? Have you ever done this? Have you ever done that? You know, and it's like, have you ever gotten sick and you have to do a sparring session because your spar partner can only make it at this time and it's hella early in the morning, you didn't fucking eat and you fucking can't breathe and you're coughing and you're on your period and you go through it and you're getting hit, you're throwing shots and, you know, you come out with blood in your nose and you're coming out with, you know, coughing up blood and stuff like that, but you finish the damn thing. You know, I'm like, and so if anyone who I don't even know and they haven't even spent the time to actually look at what I do or understand what I'm all about, I'm like, man, you really don't have anything to say to me. You're like, there is no connection. It's like, we can't even relate on the same level because I can guarantee more times than not, whatever I go through, going through the fire, I would love to see you do the same thing too, but on a daily basis. You know what I mean? And so it's like, nah, what fans say, I mean, people are entitled to their own opinions, but in terms of like getting with just living it and actually dealing with it on a daily basis, good days and bad days, it's like unless you're a fighter, unless you've actually walked through the fire that I have, going through the ups and downs, and you're still here, you know, then you can't really talk to me. So that's just my whole two cents on it. And it's like it's not even relevant.
It's a good way to approach that altogether. I always tell people not to look at the comments, and obviously you found a way to negate the comments altogether. But you know, like we talked about, you are seriously fired up here. I mean, this is a very fired up Ana Julaton, and we've talked in very calm ways before. Obviously, you have a passion for the fight sports. We've talked about that many of time. But can you compare how you feel heading into this fight to anything else? I mean, you fought for world titles, and I'm sure that amped you up, but You know, can you compare this to any other fight that you've had? Because you seem awfully fired up here, and, you know, I've only talked to you for a few months now, since right before Mayweather-McGregor. I think that was the first time that we talked and talking about that fight and everything. But can you compare this feeling to any other fight you've had?
Oh, man, it's so reminiscent of when I won my first world title. It's like where I feel like the whole world is against you, and you know, but in your head, it's like, despite what everyone's saying, how you may feel during training and all that other stuff, it's like, you just don't see it any other way. It's like, you want to go through experience, you're going to do what you know you can do, and you're just going to come out and prevail. And it's for being in the fight game for as long as I have, you know, I'd say that right there is the fight. That's what, you know, us fighters try to look for as we go from one camp to the next camp, as we deal with everything else, you know, and it's such a special opportunity when you have the right opponent. Right opponent meaning that someone who's going to get you fired up, someone who's going to get you pumped up, someone who's you're going to get excited to go to the gym about. Because I mean, just like in anything that we do, you know, there's ups and downs, and so as a fighter, sometimes you may end up having a fight where you're just not all that pumped up to fight against, you know. I mean, it's as wrong as that may sound, it's just the truth. I mean, we're all humans at the end of the day. We like things, and there's things that we don't like, you know what I mean? But you just have to go through, and you got to deal with it. So in this particular fight, it's, you know, I kind of feel like the whole world is against me. And so I'm like not even paying attention to anything else, but you know, just what I'm doing at the gym, just listening to my coach, listening to my sparring partners, and just everything else that needs to take into place for me to be triumphant for February 16th. So
I was in Boston last week covering UFC 220, and Daniel Cormier said something that, and I thought of you right away because of past conversations that we had. You just popped into my head after you said this, but after our first conversation, you had talked about the comparisons that are made between your boxing pedigree and her boxing pedigree, and clearly you have respect for her as a fighter. But when people compare the two of you, you have the legitimate world title, she has the international championships and things like that. And Daniel Cormier said, when talking about his fight with Volkan Ozdemir, he goes, "Listen, there are levels to this game, and I'm going to expose that." Does that ring true when you hear things like that? Do you feel that way heading into this fight when you look at credentials between the two of you?
Oh, 100%. And oh man, it's like right when he says that, you know, I have like all these images in my head because he's so right, it's so true. But it goes for anything, whether you're in boxing or whether you're in wrestling. I mean, when I got into the wrestling room and I had to learn a little bit about that art, like I had to understand right away that there are levels to it. There's high school, there's state, then there's going to college. But then what level of college are you going to? Is it, you know, is it JUCO or is it D1? You know, are you an All-American or are you the national champion? And there's so much meaning behind all of that, you know. And boxing, it's the same exact way. And this is where I feel MMA is at sometimes. But it's starting to change a little bit. But just having people a lot more aware in terms of the different levels of the different arts and what it means for that particular competitor, or athlete, or fighter, once they step into the cage, you know what they can bring into their performance. And so, you know, Cormier, he's 100% correct. I mean, there are levels. I mean, you know, a common thing that I hear all the time is, you know, people who say they got into boxing as an amateur and they won the Golden Gloves. And I'm like, you know, that is a great achievement. You know, there's a lot of respect for it. But at the same time, too, it's not like you're going to a national tournament where you have to spend more money and you'd have higher level of competition. But it also moves you into the next phase, which can get you into the Olympic trials, you know. And there's so many realms to it. And this right here, I mean, there's a whole nother layer too that a fighter needs to be responsible for, and also their team needs to be responsible for, is understanding, you know, what brilliance can you bring that experience, and if you want to become an MMA fighter, how are you going to have that apply while you're trying to work on everything else, you know? The one fighter that I'm really paying attention to right now is Aaron Pico, because he won his last two fights off of knockouts, but he has a phenomenal background in just grappling, you know, and just in the wrestling component. He trains over at Wildcard, and just from my own experience, I understand what it takes to actually train in wild card and the culture and the type of mindset and the type of people that you are going to be surrounded with when you're in there. And when he won through a freaking body shot on his last fight, I'm like, you know, that's the same body shot I would see in a boxing ring, but it just happens to be in an MMA cage. You know, he set it up with a kick, and then he just went, bam, straight to the body. It wasn't even a jab to set it up. He just went wide open for a body shot. And I'm like, man, that is beautiful. And then there's another fight at that same Bellator card. I forget the name of the fighter, but it was like one of the preliminaries. This fighter, from what I understood, had a wrestling background or a grappling background. One of his first strikes, he went up to his opponent. It was close stance. He was conventional. Another guy was conventional. And he straight up did a lead spinning back kick, knocked his opponent out. And I'm like, man, you know. But yeah, just in terms of like going into the levels, you know, this is kind of like a tangent on that. But yeah, it's that I'd say that is the true fight on top of performing while you're on top of the physical performance is understanding and mentally knowing what your body is capable of doing.
Oh man, I'm all fired up for this fight. Joey Davis was the guy with the spinning head kick knockout. That was ferocious. Aaron Pico's body shot, that hurts to watch. Like, it hurts me. Like, how can you not? I mean, as a fighter, you look at it as beauty, and everybody else watching it's like, oof. Like, you just feel the wind leaving your body a little bit. And I can't even imagine what that felt like for Shane Crutcher, man. Unbelievable. But, you know, as far as February 16th goes, I mean, what are you expecting here? I mean, I know you're expecting a war, but do you have any expectations outside of an exciting fight for the fans? Do you see things in her game from things that you're working on in training that you may have watched that you can expose in the cage? You don't get into specifics, but have you seen anything that you'll be able to expose on February 16th?
Well, I mean, obviously I don't want to share too much of what I'm seeing and stuff, but one thing I can't say that's just public knowledge is that she didn't understand the kicking lines. And you know, that right there, I already know how long it takes to actually understand the lineups of kicks. And there's also a whole understanding with lineup of punching and stuff like that. And in the game of MMA, man, you got to be familiar with a whole bunch of different lines, you know? All I can say is, you know, is there's so many ways to win, so many ways to lose in this fight. And I think what's going to carry out is, you know, she's going to want to win. I'm going to want to win. I'm there to, you know, just to basically stop her. So that's all I can really say for that. I don't want to expose too much.
I know when we talked, you know, heading into the Lisa Blaine fight about, you know, how you felt it would end. You know, you're just like, listen, I'm just going to go in there and do my thing and get my hand raised. That was the goal here. With the way you feel about this fight, do you visualize this in a finish? Do you see this thing ending in a specific way?
Yeah, like, man, I'm so fired up. Like, I really want to just go out there and fight. I just want to be who I am, you know? I'm looking for a win. I'm looking for a fashionable one, too. I'm looking to... and it doesn't really matter if it's Heather or someone else. I mean... I'm going there and I just want to hurt someone. So that's pretty much where I'm at right now. Training's been intense. It's been incredible. And as messed up and as tired and as banged up as I feel right now, man, I got tons of energy that I'm pulling from. You know, I'm pulling that heart muscle and my mind muscle and that motion, man. And it's like I'm always challenging it and testing it on a daily basis. And so it's like if I were to close it out, I would say it reminds me of back when I was teaching martial arts full time and I was a self-defense instructor. And, you know, one of my goals on a daily basis was whoever I was talking to, whether it was a child or an elderly person or a teenager, someone who needs confidence and stuff like that, is me making sure that they have the proper skill conceptually and emotionally and physically to know what they're capable of. And for me, you know, there's something about that, and there's something about the mindset and the way that I was living in that time of my life. And, you know, it's nice to be able to bring that back to where, you know, I'm going in there and it's like, man, there's just no fear. I'm going there to work. I'm going there to do my job. And, you know, if done correctly, you know, I really feel like, you know, there's going to be some stopping, a lot of stopping hopefully not so much stopping that we're not going to have the rematch, you know what I mean? But yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
Ana, it's always very fascinating to chat with you. I look at things in a whole different angle, and there are very few people that can make 36 minutes go by as quickly as you make it go by. So always a pleasure to chat with you. Anything else you want to get off your chest, where to find, follow you, any shout-outs, anything like that before we wrap up here?
Oh, man, I just want to say thank you, and thank you for that nice compliment. I want to say give out a couple of big shout-outs. One to Foodie Fit for helping me out with my nutrition and just making sure that I'm able to sustain all my health and energy on a daily basis. To Esprit Med Spa with my girl Mahara. She's taking care of my body. She's helping me just always stay in balance with my feminine side and just making sure that my skin's all great. Big shout-out to Barna and Management, Gold Spike Legal, Russell Collins, my lawyer, and also Brett Raymer, who's also in coercion with managing me. Brett Raymer is the one of the co-hosts for the show Tanked on Animal Planet. Big shout out to my team, Angela Reyes, Sergio Lopez, Frank Mir for helping me out, Bella Mir for helping me out, and Mrs. Mir for being so supportive. And big shout out to my mom and Tita Nora. I better stop right there, otherwise I'll take another like 10, 15 minutes because I already know I'm already missing some other folks. But yeah, thanks for letting me do that shout out real quick.
Yeah, no problem. Ana, best of luck in the rest of training. Best of luck on February 16th. Really looking forward to this. I'm about as jacked as we could possibly get at this point. So all the best to you, and we'll see you on February 16th.
Oh, sweet. Okay, thank you so much, Mike. You have a great day.
All right, you too. Thanks again.